In this video, we'll be seeing in brief about what are the lathe operations, how it is done, and how the tool is placed to perform such operations. So first, let's start with the turning operation. So for almost all the operations that are done in the lathe, only a single point cutting tool is used as a tool, and it is placed in the tool post in the carriage. Only for very few operations the tool is placed in the tailstock, for some operations like drilling, reaming, tapping, etc. So first we shall start with the turning operation. So in turning operation, a single point cutting tool, it moves axially along the side of the workpiece. So in the image you can see the tool, cutting tool, it moves along the axis. So axis is nothing but the center line of the workpiece. So it moves along the direction of the axis and it removes the material, including it may be a taper, one chamfer and a contour. So there are typically machined at small radial depth of cut, and multiple passes are made until the end diameter, that is the required diameter, is achieved. So this diagram, it shows about the turning operation in a workpiece, and the tool is moved against the workpiece. This is a feed off direction, and the workpiece keeps on rotating. So when the tool is moved against the workpiece along the axis of direction, the material is removed until the required diameter is achieved. Next one is facing. So facing is nothing but producing some uniform face, because when we are taking a workpiece for an machining process, it is not necessary that it should be of a very proper stage. So it will be of many oxide, many dirt on that, many rust on that. So to remove everything and to give a better surface finish, we are using this facing operation. So it is also done with the help of a single point cutting tool, which moves radially along the end of the workpiece. So it removes a thin layer of material to provide a smooth flat surface. The depth of the face typically very small, may be machined in a single pass or a multi pass, may be reached by machining at a smaller axial depth of cut and making multiple passes. So this diagram, it shows about the facing operation, which is done at the end of the workpiece. So the next operation is about thread cutting. So thread cutting means to produce some threads in the outer surface. So all this facing, turning, thread cutting, all these operations, it comes under the external operation. So it is done in the external surface. So for this thread cutting operation also, a single point threading tool, typically with a 60 degree pointed nose. So we know that nose radius, it plays a major role in a single point cutting tool. So while doing a thread cutting operation, the nose radius should be of 60 degree, and it has to move axially along the side of the workpiece, cutting threads into on the outer surface. The threads can be cut at a specified length and pitch, and it may require multiple passes to be formed. So this image, it shows a thread cutting operation in an external surface, where the nose radius of the tool that has chosen for doing the thread cutting should be of 60 degree. That is the most important thing for a thread cutting operation. And the next one is drilling. So this drilling, all these type of done as a internal operation. So this comes under the category of internal operations. So a drill, it enters the workpiece axially through the end and cuts the hole with a diameter equal to that of the tool. So here we cannot specify the diameter. So whatever the drill bit we are taking, so according that diameter only we'll get the hole. And for this type of operations, the tool is not placed in the tool post, but it is placed in the tailstock. So the next one is boring. So once after the drilling operation is done, a boring operation is done to enlarge the holes produced by the drilling. So we know that drilling operation, only the diameter of the drill bit will be achieved as a hole, but in a boring operation, it is used to enlarge the hole that is made by drilling. a boring tool, it enters the workpiece axially and cuts along an internal surface to form different features such as steps, tapers, chamfers and contours. The boring tool is a single point cutting tool. And the next process that can be done in a lathe machine is a reaming process. So this reamer, this tool is also placed in the tile stock only. It enters the workpiece axially through the end and enlarges the existing hole to the diameter of the tool. Reaming, it removes a minimum amount of material and is often it is performed after drilling to obtain more accurate diameter and a smooth internal finish. So first with a drilling tool we will be making a hole, and boring it is used to enlarge the hole that is made by a drilling, and this reaming process it also enlarges the hole but also provides a better surface finish for the internal surface. So these are some of the operations that are done with the help of a lathe. And the next one is capstan and turret lathe. So these are some of the special type of lathe available, but mostly common used lathe is a center lathe, which we saw in the previous video. And now let us see about what is this capstan and turret lathe. So a turret lathe, it is used to manufacture any number of identical work pieces in a less time. So in a normal lathe we can perform only one operation at a time, but this type of special lathes are used for multitasking at a time, so many components can be produced at a single time. So for the first time in 1860, Pratt and Whitney developed this capstan lathe. So the capstan and turret lathe, it consists of a bed, all geared headstock, a saddle provided with a four station tool post is to hold four different tools, and a tool post fitted at the back of the carriage, it holds a parting tool in an inverted position. The tool post mounted on the cross slide is indexed by the hand. So index is nothing but changing of the position, moving forward with the help of the levers we'll be moving forward or backward in the sideward, so that is called as the indexing. And this machine, it doesn't contains any tailstock, but in its place a hexagonal turret is mounted on a slide which rests upon the bed. So all the six faces of turret can hold six or a number of different tools. The turret can be automatically indexed and each tool brought in a line with the lathe axis in a regular sequence. The workpieces are held in collets or in chucks. So these are the components of a capstan and a turret lathe. So this images, it shows the capstan and turret lathe, and you can observe that there is no tailstock. So you can see a headstock and a carriage, but there is no tailstock at all. Instead of that, there is some turret and some indexing mechanisms to switch over between the tools. And you can see the multi-headed tool post over here, which can hold four to six tools at a time. So first one is the capstan or a ram type lathe. This machine, it carries a hexagonal turret. So this is mentioned as a turret on a ram or a short slide. Usually the ram is used for the forward and backward movement. This type of machine is lighter in construction, and it is suitable for machining bar in a smaller diameter. So the tools are mounted on the square turret and six faces of a hexagonal turret. The feeding movement is obtained when the ram moves from left to right, and when a ram is moved backward, the turret indexes automatically and a tool mounted on a next face comes in an operation. So why do we need this indexing, particularly in this capstan and turret lathe? Because they are multi-tooled lathe. There will be four to six different tools in the tool post. So each and every time we cannot just rotate. So in order that if one operation is completed, the next one comes immediately. So like dialing, it comes up once the one operation is completed, the next tool comes into the action. So for this purpose only we are using the indexing mechanism. And this is a diagram of a capstan lathe where there is no head tailstock at all. And the next one is turret or a saddle type lathe. So the turret lathe is another type of lathe machine, and it is used for repetitive production of same duplicate parts, which by the nature of their cutting process are usually replaceable. The hexagonal turret is shown in the figure. It is mounted directly on a saddle, and a whole unit moves forward and backward on the bed base to apply feed. This type of turret lathe machine is the heavier in construction. It is particularly adapted for larger diameter bar work and chucking work. The machine can take in a longer work pieces than that in a capstan lathe. So the next one is differences between a capstan lathe and a turret lathe. So if we take a capstan lathe, it is a light duty machine, whereas turret lathe is a heavy duty machine. Turret is mounted on the ram, and the ram is mounted on the saddle. So the turret head is directly mounted on the saddle, and saddle it slides over the bed base in a turret lathe. The saddle will not be moved during machining in a capstan lathe, whereas saddle is moved along with the turret head during machining. The lengthwise movement of a turret is less. The lengthwise movement of a turret is more. Short work pieces only can be machined. Longer work pieces can be machined. It is easy to move the turret head as it slides over the ram. It is difficult to move the turret head along with the saddle. The turret head cannot be moved crosswise, whereas in a turret lathe it can be moved crosswise. As the construction of the lathe is not rigid, heavy work cannot be given, but it is a rigid structure, so heavy works can be done since it is a heavy duty machine. It is used for machining work pieces up to diameter of 60 mm, whereas in a turret lathe it can machine up to a maximum of 200 mm diameter. Collet is used to hold the workpiece. Jaw chuck is used to hold the workpiece. So these are the differences between capstan and turret lathe. Thank you for watching.